Till my high school years, when my family moved to Florida, I lived in a town known as Brooklyn, New York. Brooklyn in those days was an exciting place to grow up, at least for me, in the sense it was a place where I learned how to play all kinds of games with a little ball, a round ball. You had to be very resourceful in New York. But not only baseball, there were games called stickball and punchball and stoop ball and slap ball, and it just went on and on. You just made up these games. So growing up in New York also allowed me to be exposed to a number of positive cultural experiences, the arts, museums, theater, and of course, Major League Baseball. And there were many other positive things about growing up in a big city like New York. It taught me really to be resourceful, to learn some street smarts of survival. It taught me not to be bothered by large crowds or a lot of traffic. To this day, I'm very comfortable in a large city. It taught me a great deal about getting along with people from all kinds of diverse backgrounds. But there was also something that was quite negative about growing up in Brooklyn, because it was there that I learned to speak the language of the streets. In other words, gutter talk, filthy, vulgar, dirty words. In fact, my speech, I'm told, was so foul that I was accused of corrupting an entire summer camp of boys and girls. But when I came to faith in Christ as an 18-year-old freshman at University of South Florida, one of the first sins that I became acutely aware of that just had to go was my filthy speech. I can still recall how the Lord first convicted me of this sin. I was entering my dormitory room at USF when I cut my wrist on the lock of the door. It was sticking out for some reason, and I proceeded to let out some inappropriate exclamations that included taking the name of the Lord in vain. But what I didn't realize, and to my surprise, when the door was fully opened, I saw the fellow who had recently led me to faith in Christ sitting there and waiting for me. And when he heard me speak like this — he had never heard me speak like this before, I don't think — but the look on his face of extreme disappointment, just it hit me hard. And actually, for the first time ever in my life, I realized that my manner of speaking was wicked and sinful. And I can still recall saying to my friend, who had this look of great, not only disappointment, great dismay on his face, I said, "I shouldn't have said that, should I?" And of course, he agreed. And later that day, I went before the Lord alone and asked him to clean up my language and give me a new vocabulary. And praise God, he did. That's never really been an issue after that. But I have since learned that you don't have to grow up on the streets of Brooklyn, New York, or any big city to have a corrupt tongue. The Bible teaches that every Christian has problems with their speech. It's not necessarily using dirty, vulgar words, but nonetheless, every Christian struggles with using their words properly, and that's why the Bible has a great deal to say about how a believer in Christ should speak, supposed to talk. And one of the places in Scripture that deals with our speech is our study tonight, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 29. Now, we're not going to cover all of this. There's just so much in this verse, but I do want to begin to look at this verse. Here's what the Apostle Paul said. He said, "Let no unwholesome words proceed from your mouth, but only such a word as is good for edification according to the need of the moment, so that it will give grace to those who hear." Now, this command by Paul follows several other commands given by the apostle, in which he tells the Ephesians that they are to put off certain sinful habits of behavior, and they are also to put on certain godly habits of behavior. So, as we have studied, in verse 25, he told them to put off lying and start speaking the truth to one another. In verse 26, he told them to put off sinful anger, the anger of wounded pride, and to put on righteous anger, the anger of those who are zealous for God's house. God's honor, rather. And last week we looked at verse 28, in which Paul tells those Christians who were still stealing, not as a way of life, but dabbling in it, to just stop it altogether and to replace that lazy, selfish behavior of taking from others what doesn't belong to you, replace it with the godly, unselfish behavior of working hard, hard enough that you earn enough money not only to support yourself and your family, but to give to others. And folks, all of these commands, as you know, dealing with our behavior, they flow out of the great truths of verses 22 through 24. Let me read them to you again. That in reference to your former manner of life, you lay aside the old self, which is being corrupted in accordance with the lusts of deceit, and that you be renewed in the spirit of your mind and put on the new self, which in the likeness of God has been created in righteousness and holiness of the truth. Now, in these verses, what Paul is talking about is our initial experience of salvation in Christ. God, at that moment, when we trusted Christ as our Savior, He inwardly transformed us in that He removed our old sin nature that was corrupt and deceitful and filled, Paul says, with lustful desires, and He replaced it with a brand new nature, a divine nature, which has been created in righteousness and holiness of the truth. Therefore, Paul's message to us in these following commands, when he says to put off certain behavior, put on other behavior, that is to say, he's saying, since we are now new creatures in Christ, with a new nature that is holy, then we need to conduct ourselves in a new manner, a manner that is holy. That's the point of these verses. In other words, he's saying, since you already laid aside the old sinful nature, now lay aside the old sinful habits of lying and anger and stealing, and since you already have put on the new righteous nature, now put on those new habits of speaking the truth, righteous indignation, and being generous with others. That really sums up Paul's message. And so that brings us tonight to verse 29. Because in this verse, Paul is going to address the way we talk. Not in the sense of speaking the truth instead of lies, he's already done that. But in the sense of the kind of words we are to use when we speak to one another. So once again, I want to read to you verse 29. Let no unwholesome word proceed from your mouth, but only such a word as is good for edification, according to the need of the moment, so that it will give grace to those who hear. Now notice, the first thing that Paul does is he tells us about the speech of our old self, the way we used to talk before we were saved, and how we are not to talk like that anymore. This is how we used to talk. This is the old man, the old self. Don't do this, he says. Let no unwholesome word proceed from your mouth. Now, this particular Greek word that is translated, at least in my translation, I preach from the New American Standard Bible, unwholesome, it has a host of synonyms that help to describe its meaning. Because frankly, this is a very broad word. It's not a narrow word, it's a broad word. So it could be translated rotten, corrupt, putrid, worthless, foul, and even disgusting. It's actually a word used in Greek literature to speak of rotten trees and rotten fruit. So while the thought behind this word is rather broad, essentially, I want you to understand this. What Paul is commanding us is not to use any words that have a rotten, bad, corrupting, note this, influence on others. This would certainly include vulgar talk, curse words, profanity, dirty jokes or stories, crude language. But I want you to know it's not limited to that. It's not limited to those types of words, words that would be in the arena of obscenities. Certainly no Christian should ever have foul, vulgar words with dirty sexual connotations proceed from his mouth. As one Bible teacher put it, he said, unwholesome language should be as repulsive to us as a rotten apple or a spoiled piece of meat. It's corrupt. It's rotten. But as I just mentioned, the unwholesome speech that Paul is referring to, it's broader than dirty language. It also includes words that are unkind and words that are detrimental and can harm people. In other words, speech that tears down, speech that has a negative, corrupting effect on others is really the heart of what Paul is talking about. And the reason we know this is Paul's point, and not simply indecent words, is that in each of the other areas of behavior that Paul addresses, the lying, the anger, the stealing, he has told us that the new man is to behave in the complete opposite way of the old man. So instead of lying, we do just the opposite, which is what? We tell the truth. Instead of sinful anger, we are righteously indignant. We care more about the Lord's honor than our wounded pride, just the opposite. Instead of stealing from others, we work hard to earn money to give to others. It's just the complete opposite. Now, if all of these previous commands deal with opposites in behavior, then it only makes sense that in telling us how we are now to speak, Paul will also give the opposite. That's exactly what he does. Notice, though we're not going to get into this in depth tonight, but I just want to make a point. Notice that in the second part of verse 29, he teaches that our words should edify others. That's just the opposite. But only such a word as is good for edification. And what edification means essentially is to build up. It means to encourage someone, to say those things that are beneficial and constructive. So, if Paul teaches us that in our words we are to build others up, then the opposite of building them up is tearing them down, saying something that will be harmful to someone. So in commanding us to not allow any unwholesome words to proceed from our mouths, he is actually telling us not to say anything that would have a negative influence, a negative effect on those who hear us. I want you to understand this because this is not simply about vulgar talk. It's about talk that can involve and be involved in any area of life. See, our speech is incredibly significant, because what we say profoundly influences others. And if we are not careful, our words will have a profoundly negative influence on them. This is precisely what the New Testament teaches in many places, but the most prominent one is James chapter 3. You would be wise to turn there. James chapter 3, starting at verse 1, James writes this. He says, "Let not many of you become teachers, my brethren, knowing that as such we will incur a stricter judgment. For we all stumble in many ways. If anyone does not stumble in what he says, he's a perfect man, able to bridle the whole body as well. Now, if we put the bits in the horse's mouth so that they'll obey us, we direct their entire body as well. Look at the ships also. Though they're so great and are driven by strong winds, are still directed by a very small rudder, wherever the inclination of the pilot desires. So also the tongue is a small part of the body, and yet it boasts of great things. See how great a forest is set aflame by such a small fire. And the tongue is a fire, the very world of iniquity. The tongue is set among our members as that which defiles the entire body and sets on fire the course of our life and is set on fire by hell. For every species of beasts and birds, of reptiles and creatures of the sea is tamed and has been tamed by the human race, but no one can tame the tongue. It's a restless evil and full of deadly poison." Now, at the beginning of this passage, James is warning against those men in the church who would rush to be teachers of the word. They want to be teachers. He's warning them to stop and just consider the seriousness of teaching the Bible because of the potential of misusing the tongue to speak error, to say those things that might mislead somebody. When you speak for God, you don't want to make any mistakes. You're dealing with lives. You don't want to say anything inappropriate. You don't want to give the wrong guidance. You don't want to give the wrong teaching. That's a very serious issue. And there's a real possibility that this will happen, that you will teach error, that you will misapply something, that you will say something inappropriate, because the tongue is so prone, James says, to say inappropriate and sinful things. And we have a very hard time, he says, controlling the tongue. And even though it is a relatively small organ in our body, James says it has the power to drastically influence people by directing their lives. Did you get that? He speaks of the bit in the mouth of a horse. It directs a powerful horse. This little bit directs a powerful horse. And a small rudder directs a great ship. But he says the tongue not only, and he's using the word tongue for our speech, but the tongue not only directs lives, the tongue also has the power to destroy lives. That's the great danger. Listen, medically speaking, the tongue, it's not much. It's a 2-ounce, 4-inch slab of mucous membrane that wraps itself around nerves and muscles to help us chew, taste, and swallow. That's medically speaking what the tongue is. But though very small, James says that it is incredibly powerful. And he compares it to a fire that can very quickly spread and destroy an entire forest. That's exactly what the tongue is capable of doing. It is capable of destroying lives. It is capable of ruining lives. How? Well, there's so many ways. Criticizing others, spreading rumors, speaking unkind words, destroying a person's reputation, offending people, insulting people, teaching error, teaching false doctrine, verbally abusing people, especially children, destroying a marriage and the words that you say. Splitting an entire church comes from words. And so much more. That is the destructive force of the tongue. And that's why Paul says in Ephesians 4:29, don't let any unwholesome, corrupt, rotten, negative, tearing down speech proceed from your mouth because of the incredible damage it can do. I once heard a man say that in South America, he said, there is a snake called the two-step snake. It's called this because its bite, its venom, is so deadly that you take two steps and you die. I believe what it does is it paralyzes the heart almost immediately. Well, words can do the same thing. They can swiftly kill a relationship. Words can poison minds. Words can destroy someone's faith. But listen closely, because the tongue, meaning our words, it's really not the source of the problem. It's the expression of the problem. See, the tongue only expresses what's in the heart, what's in the human heart. Jesus addressed this issue very clearly in Matthew chapter 12. Now, before we look at that, I want you to understand the context of what I'm about to read to you is that Jesus has just been accused by the Pharisees of being demonic. Demonic. Our men's Bible study was just studying this on Friday. But the Pharisees, after seeing Christ do miracle after miracle after miracle, they concluded that he's demonic and he casts out demons by the power of Satan. But he proceeds to explain why they spoke against him like this. This is not ordinary unbelief. This is confirmed, hardened unbelief. Unbelief that sees the evidence and says, no, not accepting it. So he proceeds to explain why they spoke against him like they did. It's because they were just speaking those things that were already in their hearts. Hardened unbelief, wicked rebellion against God. Here's what he said, starting in verse 33 of Matthew 12. He said, either make the tree good and its fruit good, or make the tree bad and its fruit bad. For the tree is known by its fruit. You brood of vipers, how can you, being evil, speak what is good? For the mouth speaks out of that which fills the heart. The good man brings out of his good treasure what's good, and the evil man brings out of his evil treasure what's evil. But I tell you that every careless word that people speak, they shall give an accounting for in the day of judgment. For by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned. See, Jesus is telling them that they will be judged by the words that come out of their mouths, even careless words. Why did he mention that? We would call this a slip of the tongue, because what comes out of our mouths, even a slip of the tongue, accurately expresses what's already in our hearts. Remember, he is condemning the Pharisees. So the Pharisees spoke evil words against Jesus because their hearts were evil and opposed to him. Some of you remember dear old Dr. J. Vernon McGee. I'll refrain from giving my Dr. McGee imitation. But I love the way he used to put this. He said, what's in the well of the heart will come up through the bucket of the mouth. And he probably added the word friends to it. See, the words in an unsaved person, the words they speak, it reveals a great deal about them. It reveals the truth about them. They are sinful, and their thinking is totally depraved. The way unsaved people speak is simply a reflection of who they really are. What they are on the inside comes out in their words. They use profanity because that's what's in their hearts. That's what they're thinking about. They tell dirty jokes. They laugh about sexual immorality because that's what they think about. That's what's already there. That's in their minds. It's in their hearts. They slander others with malicious statements because hatred of others is already in their hearts. Listen, when the Apostle Paul wants to prove that all men are sinners in these grand chapters in Romans where he puts the world on trial and he is proving that Jews are sinners, Gentiles are sinners, people who didn't know the written revelation of God, they're sinners, moral people are sinners. What does he turn to make his point? He turns to our speech as the condemning evidence. What comes out of our mouths, Paul says, that's what's in your heart. That proves my point. In Romans chapter 3, starting in verse 10, here's what the apostle says. He's quoting from the Old Testament, but this is the point about our speech. He says, as it is written, there is none righteous, not even one. There is none who understands. There is none who seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they have become useless. There is none who does good. There is not even one. Now watch this. He moves from saying we're all sinners to here's our speech. Their throat is an open grave. With their tongues they keep deceiving. The poison of asps is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. So what Paul is saying here, and he's giving us, is a look into the heart of every unregenerate individual, the way we were before we were saved. When he says that their throat is an open grave, that's rather graphic. He means that when they open their mouths and foul, poisonous, deceptive words come out, their mouths are open. This is what comes out. It allows us a glimpse into their heart, which is like looking into someone's grave in the sense that what you'll see is just filth and decay. This is the way all of us were before we were saved. We spoke evil words because our hearts were totally evil. Out of the abundance of our hearts, evil words poured out. We couldn't help it. Why couldn't we help it? Because this is what came naturally to us. All we had was a sin nature. So what else is going to come out but sinful words? Sinful words that revealed a sinful nature. But when Christ came into our lives, when he gave us salvation, all of that changed. Because he has given you a brand new nature so that we become, and we have become, different on the inside. And because we have a new nature, a nature that is characterized by righteousness and holiness, our speech should reflect that. That's not always the case, though. It's not always the case. And it's really why Paul is telling the Ephesians not to let unwholesome words proceed from their mouths. Listen, if the Ephesians didn't have a problem with this, or if Christians in general didn't have a problem with this, Paul would never write this. The only reason Paul writes this is because that was a problem in the church at Ephesus. See, Christians don't always speak like they should. Wholesome speech doesn't come automatically to every believer in Christ. Remember, most of the Ephesians came out from where? From pagan backgrounds. Most of them were not Jewish. They were not people who had been raised at least with some background of God's revelation. They came from pagan backgrounds, so profanity, dirty talking, that was just a way of life with them. In fact, Paul speaks more about this. If you look at chapter 5, let's start at verse 3, and then you'll see verse 4. But immorality, or even impurity, or greed must not even be named among you as is proper among the saints. Don't be immoral. But then he moves on in verse 4 to speak about their talk. He said, and there must be no filthiness and silly talk or coarse jesting, which are not fitting, but rather giving of thanks. Listen, the only reason Paul says this is because this was a problem. In other words, just because you are a Christian doesn't mean that you will immediately stop speaking unwholesome words and start speaking wholesome words that build others up. This is a major problem in Christian circles. Even when we try to be funny sometimes, we are putting people down. We are negative in our talk. We harm people. We don't build them up. This is a very significant issue. And perhaps the best biblical example that believers can still struggle in this area of speech is none other than the Apostle Peter. Do you remember that Jesus told Peter that you will deny me three times? Now, Peter had said he would never do this, but Jesus said, you will deny me three times. According to Matthew 26, verse 74, Peter not only denied the Lord, but at the end he did it with cursing and swearing. Peter did that. A man who had spent 3 years with the perfect, pure, sinless Son of God is cursing and swearing and saying, I don't know the man. Do Christians have problems with their speech? Absolutely. So, if you struggle in this area of speech and you harm people, it may not be cursing, it may be cursing, but you've harmed people, you speak negatively, you poison them, you're sarcastic, you're biting in your speech. And it may very well be that you tend to do this more when you're around people like this, whose speech is vile and vulgar, and you work with people like this. That's a hard thing. What do you do? How do you protect yourself from having those thoughts and those words in your mind? What can you do so that they don't just, you don't digest them and then they come out? What do? You have to work hard at having a clean mind, a clean heart. This is not a matter of, Lord, help me and leave it at that. You've got to do something. See, if the mouth speaks out of the abundance of the heart, then you have to fill your heart, which I'm using as a synonym for your mind. Fill your heart and your mind with those things that are good, those things that are wholesome. So ask yourself, and I'm asking, what kind of music do you listen to? What kind of television shows do you watch? What kind of movies do you watch? They may be corrupting you with unwholesome words. So fill your mind with God's word. Fill your mind with truth. Read good books. And of course, dwell on the word of God. Dwell on words that are good and wholesome. Listen to Philippians 4:8. Paul said, finally, brethren, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is of good repute, if there is any excellence and anything worthy of praise, dwell on these things. The thought is ponder these things, not casual thoughts, but really give your mind to thinking and dwelling and meditating on this kind of stuff. So fill your mind with this, these things, and your words are going to reflect it. Let's bow for prayer. The Spirit of God has convicted you, as he did me many, many years ago, then ask the Lord to help you, give you a new vocabulary. But you have the responsibility to fill your mind with truth. Yes, God will enable you to do what's right, to speak truth, but it's your responsibility to get into the Word. It's your responsibility to read the right kind of books, watch the right things on television or movies if you do that, your entertainment. Be careful. Be careful. Don't conform to this world. You've been transformed if you know Christ. You have a brand new nature, so don't revert to the old way of life. Ask the Lord to help you. And next time we see we get into this and we study Ephesians 4 on Sunday, on these Sunday nights, we'll see what Paul says about edifying speech, speech that gives grace to others. That ought to be our desire. Father, we thank you. We thank you that this is an issue that you don't leave us to wander and wonder about on our own. This is an issue, Lord, of incredible significance and very practical. It's our talk is what we do. We talk. We're different than the animals. We communicate with one another. Help us, Lord, to be mindful of the words we speak. May they be words that are not unwholesome, words that do not put people down and poison their minds, words that are not harsh and angry, and words that are not corrupting, certainly no vulgar talk. But Lord, help us to be careful of what we think about, careful of who we hang around, careful of what we watch and listen to. Lord, I pray that even though we haven't studied, other than just touch on it about edifying speech, I pray that you'll help each of us to be mindful of how we speak to one another, how we speak to others. We are certainly to speak the truth, but we are to speak words that build others up and encourage them, and words that are beneficial, giving grace for the need of the moment. So I pray that you will help us to take these truths to heart and to do something about it. Be obedient. I also pray, Lord, for any here without faith in Christ, that you will open their hearts, give them a longing to know you, Lord, a longing to be set free from their sin, a longing to know not simply that their sins are forgiven, but that they have a relationship with you, something that's precious, something that is beyond total comprehension, to know the living God and walk with him. So we pray that you'll do that work, Lord. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we thank you for coming. Have a wonderful week, and you are dismissed.